I bow to all the seekers of truth. Yesterday, you have been explained about the subtle being within us, the subtle instruments within us described in the Bible of Tree of Life, working out this last breakthrough of Self-Realization. And this happening is a living happening, a spontaneous happening, the way a seed sprouts spontaneously when it is embedded in the Mother Earth. The problem with the human mind is such that he thinks, or it thinks, that it can work out its own realization, its own emancipation. We do not understand a simple thing, that at a human level we do not do anything that is living. We cannot germinate a seed, leave alone that. We cannot even create anything that is dead. We can just transform one dead into another form. But we cannot understand that whatever we may try, we cannot lay our hands on the living process. Only after Self-Realization you are entitled, you get powers to do living work. That is the sign of a person who is born again, who is a yogi, who has had a union with the Divine. It is not those who proclaim or announce or advertise that we are something special, selected people, that we have the powers, or that we can take you to Divine. One can really produce results. Results can only be produced of living process when you have the power of your spirit. We have heard about Christ who cured people, and he cured at that time, in such a short time as it was, hardly about 21 people. And he was crucified. We could not bear the truth that he was the Son of God. Now maybe one may create big, huge organizations in his name, make big money in his name, and do all kinds of things. But when he was there, he was present, they denied him. So, as we see, within ourselves there is this power which has to manifest. We should be very anxious to get our Self-Realization. If I say there is a diamond available here, just free, is your own, people would come not only from San Diego, but also from Australia, India, Japan, and all over the world, rushing for it. But when I say there is this diamond within you, in your heart, Still we are identified with so many falsehoods that we do not want that diamond to shine in our attention. It's a surprise. But I'm not surprised because we are still ignorant about it. We do not know how beautifully we are made, how in our evolutionary process we are built in so beautifully, the whole information about the truth. Only this machinery has to work out. Only this has to get connected with the Divine. If we really logically, intelligently understand that the living process has to work spontaneously and you can't do anything about it, you can understand how Sahaja Yoga works. It's all there. One does not have to do anything, it's all there. Like a little seed, a minutest one maybe, has all the maps of all the trees it is going to produce. In the same way, within you lies this potential which is to be manifested. You have been also told about the left and right side within us. Left and right side are the only two sides in which our attention can move, which represents our sympathetic nervous system. That is, when you go into any emergency, supposing you are rushing somewhere or running, your sympathetic goes into action and creates the results necessary for that action. For example, you have to run. So the sympathetic will start pumping the blood fast, will start breathing fast. But what brings it back to normal is the central path, what we call, represented in the medical terminology as parasympathetic nervous system. So in our own effort we can only go to the left or right. But when we try to go too much to the left and right, we create problems which we cannot explain and we cannot understand. The first and foremost problem we create is the physical problem. Today there are so many diseases we cannot understand how these diseases came into being and what is the nature of its creation, or how are we going to get rid of this? Everybody is afraid of that unknown disease. And these unknown diseases can crawl up to anyone, whatever you may say, unless and until you become the Spirit. How they are caused is a very simple thing to understand. The physical problems come to us because of our imbalances. In various ways we try to go to the left or to the right. Now let us see how cancer is caused, because that is the headache of today, or maybe of yesterday. Today's headache is something else. Cancer is caused only because we do not keep to our temperament life. If I say that this is the center that is formed by the left and the right side, then this center is providing the necessary vital energy to the left and right side equally. But supposing you are a very futuristic person, you are planning too much, thinking too much, then what do? You use your right side too much. As a result, this moves this way. Also, the center now constricts. There's no space in between, left in the center for the vital energy to flow. At this juncture, when you have moved too much, from the left side, if any emotional disturbance comes in, or if you go to somebody who is practicing black magic and all kinds of left-sided negative things, or else you might meet with an accident or a shock, this breaks. And when this center breaks, you lose your connection with the center. The controlling agency, that is the central nervous system, does not play any more part. And what happens to you? That the growth of the cells become malignant, means they grow on their own. There's no relationship to the growth of other cells. For example, suddenly you'll find such a person will have a nose increasing in size, or you'll find an ear increasing in size, overpowering all others. Or we can say that it becomes a very dominating cell. This is a simple thing that happens in cancer. Luckily, we have now in Delhi University the understanding of Sahaja Yoga very well, because we have cured many people of somehow they were very highly placed in life, of cancer and other diseases. So they have accepted it for a doctorate, and two doctors have got now their MD in two subjects. One was a psychosomatic disease. One of the psychosomatic disease is cancer. There are so many others. And another one who has got his doctorate is in the physical fitness and vulnerability to diseases. Now there are seven other doctors in London who are doing research on it. And it's remarkable how, after realization, you get out of the clutches of physical sickness. So what happens? When the Kundalini rises, what she does, she pierces through these constricted chakras, repairs it, and brings it back to its normal position, repairs it. And I have seen our President of India getting cured of his cancer in 10 minutes' time, that too on the aeroplane, through surgery. But it is easy to deal with an Indian, because they know what is a Kundalini, and they know what is a saint. They will not easily take to these fake persons. Though you are great seekers of a very high quality, that understanding is there in India more, because they know more about the roots and not about the tree, as you know more about the tree. But it's such a barrier in understanding that 300 years English ruled in India, they could not learn a word. Today it's amazing, this is such a difficult Sanskrit verses about the primordial mother written by Adi Shankaracharya in the 6th century, which many Indians will find it difficult to sing. It's so beautifully sung, the whole mantras, as they say, are beautifully rendered, that even a well-equipped Brahmin cannot do by people who are not from India. They don't even know Sanskrit language. How this has happened is the manifestation of the Spirit. The manifestation of the Spirit gives you a dynamic personality. this dynamism comes to you, you can sing whatever you like, you can draw whatever you like, you can paint whatever you like. There are so many people who have become great orators and musicians, especially in India, because my work mostly has been in India. Of course, not that I am not concerned about the West. I have been, as I told you, many a times in America. But to understand the reality, the first thing we must know that money has nothing to do with the living process. In America, you'll be surprised, there has been a business offered to me that the cool breeze that I blow, if I can bottle it up, they can sell it. Everything goes into a business proposition. And that's why it is so difficult. For example, you have seen here, of course, I must say you are great people that you have come to a program which has nothing to do with money. It's something really remarkable, I must say. But today, if I was talking in India, or if I was visiting even a small village, there would have been minimum 10,000 people. Minimum. And they would get all their realization. The seeking is in the West. They're honest seekers. But what to seek is the knowledge which is in the East. It's something like somebody have the teeth but no food, and those have food have no teeth on one side, but on the other side they have teeth but no food. It is such a simple thing to get cured. Of your physical problems is the easiest. Then the second comes, is the problem, as they say, is of stress. It's a common disease in the West of the stress. What is the source of stress within us? The source of stress is very simple. That when we think, I mean these days the amount of thinking we do. First of all, when I came to America, I was very confused because of the choices you had. You walk into any bathroom, you better ask the owner, how do you operate? Otherwise suddenly you'll find you have fallen into a big swimming pool, suddenly it opens out for you. Or maybe you open some sort of a shower and it becomes a torrential rain upon you. So many choices which maddens you completely. What is there to choose about how you will have your scissors? As long as the scissor works, it should be all right. It is so complicated because so much of machinery. They have to produce so many things, so many varieties. Right from A to Z, whether it is a dress, whether it is a hairdo, whether it is a carpet, or with an ordinary thing which we call as the handle of the car. Before getting into the car, better ask the driver how it operates, otherwise you'll be locked. There is no uniformity kept about these useless material things. And so the choices are so many, you go to the shop, you go mad. You don't know what to buy. You just ask them, I just needed some, say, powder for my body. Now, which one you want? This one, this one, they'll give you 32 things You start wondering, oh God, I have only one body and 32 things, what to buy? It's so difficult to locate something that you need because you really don't know. This is natural number one, this is absurd number two, like that goes on and on and on the list. For a small nonsensical thing like that. Then tomorrow you go in the market, you find that's gone out of market. Now another 32 things have come back. All such maddening things put you to thinking, what should I do? Then we have to plan out everything in the future. It is so much so that by temperament people have become futuristic. Like they are sitting here listening to me, but they are thinking now, how will I go home? And what food I will be eating, then what music I will have. They are sitting here at present, but thinking about something that's going to happen. Then too much planning they will do. They do not know the plan of the Divine. They'll plan it out, rush, go forward, do this, go to the airport. What has happened? The plane is delayed 3 hours. Why? Because they are congestion. Holiday cancelled. They had planned the holiday a year ahead. Poor things, you see, packed everything to go somewhere. Holiday had to be cancelled because the planes are not moving. So they sit down on the airport 3 days waiting for something to happen. Nothing happens, they go home. But a yogi does not plan. He knows what's going to happen. He does not bother. But supposing a yogi gets lost on the way, then he thinks, all right, if I'm lost, there must be something here, I must see it. I am there with myself, I'm not lost. So let's enjoy. After all, what are we going to miss? It is something one has to see, that as we are so much stressed and under the domination of this watch, that we all the time rush, rush, rush. Even the jobs that we do, we are supposed to rush. You may rush as much as you like, but the problem is, your mind also rushes with it and the whole personality gets involved into it. But if you have seen a wheel, the whole wheel moves, but the axis has to be steady. If the axis also starts moving, there is stress. That's exactly what happens to us, that we start moving with all the tensions that are so-called, I call them. Now, there is a center within us which we call as Svadhisthana center. It's the second center which, as you see, is working out the void. We call this as the void, not the Zen void, but this is the void. And this area is worked out by this Svadhisthana which looks after the liver, the pancreas, the spleen, the kidneys and part of the intestines, physically or in the medical terminology we can say the aortic plexus manifested by this center works it out. Now when the center is doing this work in balance, it's all right. But when we think too much, then the same center has to convert the fat for the use of the brain to make it into gray cells. But when we think too much, then it neglects other important work which it has to do. So you get a liver trouble. I find at least 50% people in the West are suffering from liver trouble. They are not aware of it till they get to cirrhosis, to skin troubles, this, that. They will not know that they have a bad liver till they have jaundice or other diseases which are caused by liver problems. Then we have people who have lethargic livers also. So we have two types of people who have lethargic organs or overactive organs. So this Swadhisthana Chakra cannot look after its duty in a balanced way, creates a kind of an imbalance. So you neglect your pancreas, you get diabetes. It's a funny idea that is now prevalent, that we should not take sugar, because I don't know from where it has come, because they think it causes you diabetes. It does not. In India, in a village if you go, they have to put so much sugar in the tea that the spoon must stand at right angles. Otherwise they won't take. And nobody has diabetes. They have never heard about it. Never known. What is diabetes? What is that? They'll say. The reason is they don't think. They live for the moment. All right, today is the work, let's go do this farming and come home and sleep off. They don't think too much. We think about everything, plan out everything. Whatever is spontaneous also we think about. Then the third thing that happens to you is the trouble of the spleen. Now spleen is our timekeeper. It gives us a rhythm. As you have seen the rhythm today, the same way it's the rhythm of the life is kept by the spleen. When you go into an emergency, then the same spleen starts producing more red blood corpuscles for your use. Now today's life, as it is all the time shocking. Early in the morning, you read your newspaper. I think this is one of the worst habits. Because as soon as you see the newspaper, the first shock in the morning is, oh God, so many dead, plane was crushed, war has started, somebody fell from somewhere, all horrible things in the newspaper. Because newspapers don't believe in giving something good news, you see. If there will be peace and happiness, what will they publish? I don't know. So they want to give shocking news. So there's some sensation in the body. It has happened to such an extent that now unless and until the music is sensational, unless and until we get a shock all the time, we do not react. Of course, the joy part is missing, no doubt about it. So this poor spleen doesn't understand this personality which is all the time under shock. Then you get into your car and on the road there is a jam, finished. You had to reach at such and such time and there's a jam. So now you are cursing everything, sitting down there worried. Suddenly you find an accident. Then you go in the office or some place where you are working. The boss has had a quarrel with his wife. So he comes and shouts at you, another shock. All the time you are facing very arrogant, horrible people. I mean, I myself was afraid to go to shops or anything because suddenly they jump on you like a horse or sometimes like a dog. God knows how they will react on you. You get a fright. What's the matter with them? Why are they so shocking? But all of them are under stress. and they're taking it out on you. But the worst thing that happens with this spleen going crazy, that you get blood cancer. Blood cancer is caused by hectic life and for speedy life that we lead. Now the blood pressure comes from the kidney, and like that so many things are caused by one simple thing, that we think too much. What is there to think? I just don't understand. Whatever has to happen will happen. By thinking, nothing is going to stop. By thinking, we have achieved nothing. If you read Einstein, who has developed the theory of relativity, at the very outset he says that I was tired and I was lying down in my garden playing with soap bubbles, and suddenly from somewhere unknown, the theory of relativity dawned upon me. Whatever we have is there. Whatever we have to find out comes from the unknown. But thinking about it like mad just ruins us. But if I say, don't think, you cannot stop it. I know that. Because we had a wonderful doctor in Switzerland, he came and he said, Mother, do what you like, you cut my throat, you cut my head, but stop this thinking. I'm going mad with it. So you develop a momentum of thinking, you all the time thinking. Now what happens with the Kundalini? When the Kundalini rises, passes through your Ajna Chakra, you go beyond thought. It is like one wave of thought comes up and goes down, another wave of thought comes up and goes down. In the center there's a little space. So one comes from the past and goes to the future, or the future to the past. In between there's a little space, and that is the present. So when the Kundalini rises, passes through this Ajna Chakra, the one that gives you thought is the ego, and the superego on both the sides, as you can see clearly. They are sucked in. Your karmas are sucked in. Your ego is sucked in. Your conditioning is sucked in. And you stand at the present moment. Then if you want, you think. If you don't want to think, you just sit down in complete silence, enjoying yourself. You become in command. Like you are standing in the water, you are afraid of getting drowned. But if you get into the boat, you enjoy the water. But supposing you become a master swimmer, then you can save others also from the water. This is exactly what happens when a Sahaja Yogi establishes himself well, that he can give salvation to so many and can save so many people. This is how we are going to emancipate people. Now the emotional side that we have is also another extreme to which we move. And with the help of certain elements, you will be surprised, one candle can at least cure 25 mad people. At least. It's very simple. If you enlighten this light, then what happens? That enlightened light goes inside your left side and enlightens it completely, and all the negativity disappears into your collective subconscious. And you no more suffer from the left side of insanity, epilepsy, schizophrenia, all this nonsense. Because you stand in the center. You are neither on the left nor on the right, but you are in the center, you get rid of your emotional problems. Now there are spiritual problems also. Before, as we have, I told you, thinking problem, we have also physical problems like over-exertion. Now people are jogging. It's madness. I really tell you, first I thought there's some sort of an earthquake, that the old, young, everybody running, what is happening? What's wrong? Where are you running? Because you are overexerting yourself. What is the need to overexert yourself? Because now a concept is that if you are muscular, I don't know, whatever is the concept, every day changing, every day you find new things, then you become over-efficient, you become dynamic. It's absurd. We have seen in history, say, we have got the greatest statesman and the person who saved us from this horrible Hitler was Churchill, and what a fat man he was, he never did jogging in his lifetime. I mean, you must accept your body, it requires. Now, for example, if I start jogging, I'll be nowhere. Myself, because I need lot of water to protect these chakras which work out the emancipation. To me, that is much more important than becoming some sort of a cinema actress. There are many cinema actresses, so what? What have they achieved? How many people have they emancipated? So what is your ideal in life is to be decided first of all. Do you want to be all the time slave of your body? And I don't know what you get, I mean, these days nobody looks at no one. They are fed up now. And you can't make out one from another because they go to the same hairdresser, one fashion starts. I have to think, is this the same person or somebody else? I mean, it is better to grow your beard to look something different. I mean, there's no way of making out who is who. Everybody has the same hairdress, everybody has the same funny dress, everybody looking the same. They have no personality. Tomorrow a wave comes that you should put a plastic bag on your head. Everybody will be moving with a plastic bag. We have to have a personality. Why should we dress up as everybody is dressing up? Such a pressure. I know that because I have another life which you know very well, which is supposed to be the high society, so-called. And the stupidest thing we discuss in that society, like they laugh at a woman if she's wearing something that was, say, belonging to 60s. I mean, what's the harm? No, that's not modern. But what do you gain by becoming so modern, running with the fashion? What do you gain? Now the fashion in England is to have holy pants, to make holes. Imagine that cold, horrible cold that you have. What is the need to make holes in your pant to get all kinds of troubles? And then they'll have arthritis, they'll have this. First they had tight pants, so they developed varicose veins. So now they are having such loose pants that they will develop arthritis. These people are managing you. These manufacturers are befooling you. This we cannot see because we have lost our personality. So we develop so many problems also because we play into the hands of nonsenses. Now say, Indian people have lived for so many ages now, so they have learnt all the lessons. If you go and tell them that you wear a holy pant, they'll say, you get lost. Sorry, sir, we know everything. Now they are painting their hair. And when they are painting their hair, people said, why are you painting their hair? Oh, that's the fashion, what's wrong? But people become blind with that. We had three patients who became blind because they painted their hair and some sort of a thing. Punk. There were three blind punks who came to surgery. Actually, you have to punch them to talk to them. This is the society in which we live. Anybody who is sane will think I am mad. Like going to a lunatic asylum, you start thinking, am I mad or they are mad? That's how it creates a stress on us. Let us live with our own dignity. You can see Mahatma Gandhi went for his roundtable conference. He wore his dhoti. He didn't wear three-piece suit and a tail coat. That's another nonsense. Everybody in England has to wear a tail coat when they go to the Queen's party. But they can't afford, so they borrow. Some are tight, some are loose. And when you see them there, I mean, I've been to many of them, you can't recognize. And they look so absurd and clownish. But poor things, you know, all these big ambassadors have to go about with that. Because it is supposed to be a formal dress. I mean, what a formal dress it is. All these things pressurize you. They make you feel, oh, you must wear a dress like this. Even when you go to some guru, he says, all right, you all have to wear, say, orange dress. So you are forced into it. You have to wear the orange dress. From where are you going to manage getting rid of all this nonsense of forcing you to do this and forcing you to do that? But here you are so individualistic, and here you are without a personality. It is not that anybody says you have to do it, but you just do it because we have no personality. Individualism means personality. And that is what, when it is lost, you feel also your guilt and your stress. That's possible that you stand on in your own glory, in your own personality, in your own understanding of your spiritual wealth. So when that starts, another style of movement comes in like hippies. You become like a primitive person. You become like a hippie, you go about like a hippie, you wear a funny dress, become a primitive personality, and think, oh, I have done very great thing. I had some hippies with me, I told you yesterday. So I asked them, why do you dress up like this? They said, we want this kind of culture. I said, this is primitive. They said, we want to be primitive. I said, you cannot be. Your brain is modern, just by wearing these primitive things, you cannot be primitive. Accept it. Accept your personality. And now, you have your realization and it will work out.
Wedding party.
So, with all these stresses on us, thinking too much, futuristic personality, you develop the stress. Now what happens? When Kundalini rises, you are beyond thought. That's called in Sanskrit as nirvichar samadhi, into thoughtless awareness. You are fully aware, on the contrary, you are more aware, but you are in thoughtless awareness. Now when I see this carpet in thoughtless awareness, I don't think. I don't think because if I have to think, oh Baba, this is my carpet, now I have not insured it, if somebody will run away with it, then what will happen? I won't be able to give a speech or anything, I'll be worried about the carpet only. But when I look at this carpet, I don't think. Only the joy of the creation of this carpet is just pouring into me. a beautiful, blissful feeling, that's all. I'm not thinking. Like a very still, beautiful lake which has no ripples, reflects all the beauty that is around it fully. The complete joy is reflected in a mind which is absolutely still, not reacting, not accepting, just seeing, witnessing. And this witness state comes into you and you become a tranquil and a peaceful personality. Such peace that such a person, wherever he goes, wherever he walks, a peaceful atmosphere prevails. The nature, the elements all react to such a personality. Just talking about peace or giving prizes of peace, you do not create peace. I know of people who have got Nobel Prizes of Peace are horrid. They look like some mad dogs. If you have to talk to them, take a barge pole in between. Don't know when you'll be hit with the prize they have got. And you may have to pay very dearly for meeting such a personality who is supposed to be the foundation of peace. And you find it's a fountain of violence. This is the situation today, that we are placed in a society which artificially expresses itself. There's nothing genuine, nothing innate. It's so artificial. There is somebody standing talking of God, this, that. Tomorrow you find he is a man going about with a prostitute. Can you imagine? The big organization in England, you'll be surprised that the Soho, which is the residence of prostitutes, is owned by the Church of England. How do you explain that? And the Vatican, the less said the better. And the Indian temples, you better not go there at all, because you will end up with some sort of a possession within you. You'll all get possessed. It's horrid the way they are managing black magic in those temples. So all these man-made religions have completely covered the beauty of reality. And when you see that, you start doubting God. God exists, He's there. But do not deceive yourself. Do not be deluded. Be honest and ask for the right thing. Ask for the real, and then you will find it, that it exists. Now in the spiritual field also we get lost. We have fake gurus of all kinds. They try today this trick, tomorrow that trick, day after tomorrow another trick. They'll say, now, if you pay me £500 today, you'll be able to levitate yourself and move about. What is the need to do that? You have got your seats to sit down. Why do you want to levitate and hang in the air? As it is, there is so much of jam on the streets. And are you going to create more jams there? This kind of a stupid stuff we accept with our closed minds. What has happened to our thinking? Think of your forefathers when Abraham Lincoln lived in this country, such a great personality. Do you think they would have accepted anything like this stupid? We must have our ideals to see, will Abraham Lincoln accept the stupid idea of levitation? Will Gandhiji accept such a nonsensical idea? Will Christ accept such a nonsensical idea? Then why should I? Once we realize that we are guided by these great people who came on this earth, lived with us, have given us wisdom to see for ourselves what are we doing. But these days, as I told you, I also move in the so-called high society. The greatest topic is, what guru are you going? I am going to the most expensive one. He charges now £1,000 more than the other. So the other says, all right, can I also come with you? Let me see my bank account. If I have money, I would like to go with you. It has become a craze. How can you sell God in the market? That's why Christ took a hunter and beat all such people who collect money in the name of God and who ask for money. Today that time has come that so many of them need good beatings. And if Christ was here, I'm sure He would have done it. To all those people call themselves Christ, Christ, He would have shown them what it means to sell God in the market and to collect money in the name of God. And live on that money is the greatest sin that they are committing. That's why they don't like me, because I tell the truth, because they will suffer. If they do these things, they'll have to suffer in this lifetime and also in the lives to come. Whatever is holy, whatever is auspicious, has to be done with reverence and understanding that we don't do something that is so materialistic, so cheapish, so foolish in the name of God. But there are so many who are selling in the market. It's not only plundering, it's not only cheating, it's not only thieving, but they spoil your central path, they spoil your chakras, they make you mad, they make you recluses, they take away all your money. I don't mind because you're stupid, so give away all your money, doesn't matter. Money doesn't matter so much, but they take away all that is sense within you, all that is living within you, and that's how is the most difficult thing to cure a person who suffers at the hands of these horrible sorcerers who have come in the name of God as false people. It's best that we understand the value of our life and get to your self-realization and achieve that dynamism, that personality within us, which is our own, our right, for which the God Almighty in His compassion and love has brought Sahaja Yoga for Him. It's the spontaneous happening of Kundalini awakening. May God bless you all. I have to now, yesterday we had some questions and today I think we can have one or two questions at the most. But then those who want to go can go away. But if you want to have your self-realization, you have to know that I cannot force on you. I cannot also guarantee. If you are lucky enough, you'll get your realization. And I know most of you will get it. It takes hardly any time. But those who do not want to have it should leave us in peace and be civil to us. We'll be very kind of them. Now, first of all, yesterday I answered most of your questions. And if there is anyone, you can ask me if you think it is worth asking. But as I told you yesterday, if you are hungry, you better have your realization. I've done the cooking. But if you have some question which is really lingering in your mind, I would not like you to miss the boat for that one little question, which can be quite stupid also. But it's better I give you full chance to ask me a question if there is definitely a question in your mind which you think may stand up like a jack in the box when your kundalini is rising.